Hello everyone. We're out at the animals now. They're lying by the stable. Resting. Ooh, had a nice meal. Just get a closer look. And we'll have a little talk about springtime and looking after sheep and cows when you wish to mob graze. There's our little lamb. He's not very big yet, but he's grown well, and he's the only one now, and here's beautiful Inga lying here resting after a lovely meal. There she is, gorgeous, beautiful animal. Lovely calf behind her. Yeah, looking good. And here comes my husband. On the tractor. So we'll just get a closer look at him. He's tidying up the farm. He's very busy getting rid of some old stuff we have that we don't need anymore, making lots of lovely space for the animals. So just say hello.
Hello.
So this is my husband.
Oh, John. You need this because I'm out here.
Okay, so...
Yeah. No. No Biden.
I think you said it was a Volvo. Yes, it is an old Volvo. Move on a bit. Go back to the animals. And I want to tell you a little bit about how to manage in springtime when there's no grass. And that is really a challenge. Hey, Inga. So, just put the camera here somewhere so we can do a bit of filming. And here we go. So, hi everyone, it's been a while. Today I want to tell you something about how to manage when you have a big animal like a cow. And you have sheep, and of course our mob is very small, so it's not a big farm, it's just for self-sufficiency. But when you reach late winter and early spring, it is really quite a challenge to get enough feed. And if you do not make lots of hay, you have to buy feed, and you'd rather not, because you want to save the money. Of course, although you're buying feed, and in lots of developed countries, you can get it delivered, and you just have to pay the money. And many of us have the money to pay for the feed, and the fact that you're actually getting all this very nutritious milk makes it worthwhile, because although the feed does cost something, you're not buying as much food for yourself because you're getting the milk and you're getting meat. So although you need to buy feed, it can still be very much worthwhile. So as I've said before, this year I want to try something called mob grazing, and I just explained it very shortly, that what it's all about is to leave the grass to grow. And when it's reached a certain height, you put the animals on, and you put them in a small area at a time, so that they tread down a third of the grass. That's what they've worked out, that if you give them enough to eat, an area that they will be able to feed off, maybe half a day or a whole day, they will tread down a third of the grass, and they will eat maybe half the grass, and they will throw their urine and manure on the rest, if you let them sleep there too. And that way you build up the topsoil and make your soil life so much richer, because what farming practices are doing all over the world is really stripping the land of nutrients and also microbial life. So just like feeding our gut, we actually have to make sure that the soil is fed. So when you have a bush or a tree, like the beautiful birch tree in the background, I don't know if you can see it well, any tree, they will be shedding their leaves and they will be feeding the soil with all this beautiful organic matter. But when you just keep stripping the grass and you don't have enough animals on it, you're not actually, you're actually taking more than you're giving back. So I'll do some more about mob grazing, and it's just something I'm getting to know. But this is a bit of a challenge for me, because I had no more feed. I had to buy some more, so I bought some big, some haylage, which is just a big packet that I feed, and it's quite heavy. But I realized that Inga, she was she's used to making a big amount of milk, and her body can't stop making those amounts. So she's still making maybe about, well, over 15 litres of milk a day. And if she's not getting enough feed, she's going to strip her body of so much nutrients. So I have to feed her grain, so I'm feeding her like oats. Just like oats, only it's barley. So it's I feed her 6 kilos a day, and apart from that, she has heaps of haylage. So she has a lot of food, and because I don't want her to lose any more weight, she's very skinny already now, and you can't really control it. You can just make sure that she's fed, she's full all the time. So I'm actually training them for the barb or the electric fence, because when I'm going to be mob grazing on the meadow and around here on the grasses, they'll be having the electric fence quite close to them, because it's such a small mob. So they have to learn that the electric fence it really hurts, and you don't go into it. Because behind the electric fence there'll be really beautiful lush grass all the time, so they really have to learn that electric fence is hurt. So that's one of the things, and that's what I'm sort of getting them used to now. I've got them all together in this area up by the stable, and I've never done this before. I've always just let them onto the grass, although the grass is very short. But see, I can't do that because I want the grass to grow. And because I've learned this, that I don't want to just keep biting down the grass, because when I reach midsummer, there'll be no more grass. And yeah, so I have a period now of a month or so where I have to keep them in a quite a small area and I have to feed them. So I'm going to see how I go. It's pretty exciting, but I really hope that within about 3 years you'll see that your soil is much more alive and much richer and will produce much more grass and many more herbs. And so we'll have more feed for our animals, and apparently you can also, instead of making heaps of hay, you can take the animals off the land. Here in Denmark it has to be in July, preferably in the beginning of July, and you let the grass grow all the rest of the summer, and then by October, November, December you can put animals on the land and they will eat that what has been growing on the land. Although it's all fallen down and it's full of frost, it's actually feed for them. So that's something I've never heard about before. So they'll be able to eat on the meadow their winter feed, and hopefully I won't have to buy so much hay next year. So, but because in Denmark it's very wet, and especially this area is very wet, it's a huge challenge to have them so close together, because they tread up the soil and it gets really muddy. So I've made a new area, and I'll just show you. Well, my husband has helped me a lot. Made a new area for them where they can be when it's raining. Because see, now it's, you see the soil, he's just having a drink there. Have a look at him, little beautiful lamb. See, the soil is nice and dry now, it's no problem. But as soon as we get a bit of rain, it's just one big heap of mud, and very unhealthy for the animals to be on. So and the stables here are too small. Although I could put them in here, but I just think it's too small, and that's for the cow. And I'll just take the fence off here. Oops, wait a second. Back on. I've got some more tractor work to do. That's for the sheep. It's not. They could be here, but I think it's just too small. And I've found that they really are a mob. So they really, really enjoy to be together. So now we've made this area, which I'm really happy with. Just get in and see if we can see it properly. So this is just something I made for the cow, which does not work at all. But it's about, I'd say, I'll just count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's about 6 by 5 meters altogether. And here I just put their feed in the morning, a huge pile, and they have feed for all day. And they can move around here. We have to tidy this up, so move this away so they have that corner too. And it's really a lovely area for them to be here. On a whole day they can be here and be quite comfortable. So at the moment now, you can just see out here, out onto the forest. It's very bright light, so it might be a bit hard to see from the outside. It looks like this. So I'll just put a fence in front of it. I'll just take it over with these little iron posts. These ones here. You can just see it here, the fence. And I have barbed wire on the top, which is an absolutely fantastic invention, because they respect it so much. I think they even respect it more than electric fence, because if a cow jumps over a barbed wire fence like that, she'll rip her udder and she'll might not be able to have any more babies. So it's very important she protects her udder, so she will never try to jump over a barbed wire like that. And also the sheep, the same. And a male sheep, of course, will tear his penis and testicles. So it's just really dangerous for them to jump over like something like that. So that is such a fantastic thing. So you can just have ordinary sheep's fence down the bottom. That's what we have in the meadow, at the meadow. And then you have the barbed wire on the top, which is really great. So this is our new arrangement, and they'll be here for about a month and or so, and or maybe a little bit more, while I feed them and while the grass is growing. And so now you've got to meet my husband. Maybe we'll just have a little chat with him, so you can just get to meet him, my wonderful husband. Hello, Henrik.
Hello, Katrina.
I just thought you'd like to meet my YouTubers here and to tell them something about what you're doing, maybe.
Okay. What I'm doing is cleaning up the fence, the paddocks here, because we have some old farm equipment used for horse wagons, and we don't need them anymore. So I put an ad in the newspaper, and people who want, they can get it for free, can come and get it. So that's what I'm doing. And now, just now, I'm closing the electrical fence again. So before I went through here with the tractor and the gear, and now I had to put this up again so the animals will keep in here until the grass is long enough. So we can try this mobgrazing system there. But just now I'm putting some wires together, so we just see if there's electrical, if there's a
connection
with the, so there's a shock in it. So I'll go now and turn it on.
Yeah, you can show us how you take the fork maybe, and just show us how you can see there's there's a particular way to see. Getting to know an electric fence is quite a study, and it's always been my husband who's had that in control, but now I have to learn it myself. And of course what's basically one thing is that the wire, of course,
I switch the contact on now.
He's turning on the switch. These posts. Where is it? The top of this. No, that's not the wrong one. There we are. Have a plastic top. I mean, that's just for people who don't know anything about electric fence. And, of course, the wire, which this is the best, I think, for sheep, because sheep are quite hard to keep in with the electric fence. So this wire is really effective. It's very, the electricity goes through very quickly. And if you hear it ticking somewhere, you know that there's a bad connection. But Henrik will just show how to see if there's...
Yes.
There's not so much. I can hear there's a connection over here to the ground. Oh, it's a plant. See, if there's a plant here that is connected to the fence. No, it's over here, Henrik. This one here, it's not in the plastic socket properly, so the electricity will go into the
it's connected.
Yeah, into the metal rod, and won't go through the fence properly.
Yeah. So there's no. It's a little spark.
So we need to fix that.
Yeah, put it in.
Yeah, a little bit.
That's okay.
Okay. Thank you very much, Danny.
See you later.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Okay, we'll just finish off this video. And I hope you could... No, I can't get out now. Could you turn it off, please? So this was a little bit about how to manage having your animals in a small area and keep them dry, which is really important. And another thing I've found, which is is very interesting how these domesticated animals, I can get over the fence now, thank you, domesticated animals are really habit creatures. They love that you do the same thing every day. And I was letting out the cow every day onto the grass, and she just walks around the garden feeding herself. But the grass is so short, I can't do that every day. So for a few days she would stand there calling and calling, when can I come out, when can I come out? And now I've stopped doing this, and she's gotten used to a new rhythm where I simply do the same thing every day. I give her 3 buckets of grain, one morning, one midday, one afternoon. And I give her all the haylage, and I just do the same thing every day, and that really is relaxing for her. So now she knows this is the way things are going to be, and that's perfect. So she's relaxed, and that's, I think, when you have little animals or have a little group like this, and you're not a farmer, you really learn as you go, and I just keep learning new things all the time. So it's amazing what the animals will actually accept. And I think it's fascinating also to see that a cow, for instance, it has many needs. It doesn't only need enough food and water, it also has a need to attend its young. So when now I let out the animals in the morning from their new enclosure, the first thing I do is I have a bucket of grain where I milk the cow, and she goes straight in and has her bucket, and the calf is out the back because I lock him up at night. And while she's having her grain, I milk the cow, and by the time I've finished milking, she's more or less eaten the grain, and I let out the calf. And she'll spend about an hour enjoying him having his breakfast and licking him and just being with him, because they haven't been together all night. So, and then after about an hour or so, she'll be calling for her haylage, and I'll come out and give them their daily feed. And then she fills up her belly, and she's satisfied, so she can go and eat the rest of the day. And then by about 5 o'clock, I lock him up again. And although he's on his own, he's used to it. So every night he's in there, and he's content. So it's really wonderful when you found a great rhythm where you know your animals are happy. That is a really important thing, because it is very stressful if you can feel that your animals are not happy. So the best thing for them would be to get onto the grass. They would love that. But this is the way it's going to be this year. And when the grass is beautiful and tall, they're going to have a feast. So I'll just finish off the video. So here you go, today you got to meet my husband, Henrik.